Listening Library presents Fright Night by Maren Stoffels. Translated by Laura Watkinson. Read for you by Gary Tiedemann, Carolyn Hewitt, Neil Shah, and Michael Braun. Maybe that's what happens when a tornado meets a volcano. Eminem. Murderer. I always thought death would look different. A bit like in the movies. Spectacular, sad, or perhaps scary. But your death was lonely. Even though there were four people around you, three people watching, and me, your murderer. 1 hour before Fright Night.
Sofia. The three of us are riding our bikes in a line along the narrow bike path. The only illumination comes from our lights shining over the road. The threatening words on that postcard have been on my mind all week. A few times I'd been on the verge of showing the card to Dylan, but I simply can't imagine the message is meant for him. Dylan doesn't have any enemies. Everyone at school likes him. There's no address on the card, so someone must have put it through the door in person. But who knows? Maybe it's just a silly joke. You excited? I look up. Dylan's cycling beside me, our handlebars almost touching. He's wearing a new pair of jeans and a t-shirt, and his eyes are shining. I try to imagine that he was ever seriously ill, but it's almost impossible. Yeah, sure. Dylan smiles. That doesn't sound very enthusiastic. I actually have no idea what to think about this whole Fright Night business. My suggestion was just an impulse thing, because I wanted to do something with Quinn and Dylan. Now that it's almost time, my nerves are really kicking in. It feels weird that I can't back out now. It's like the safety bars on the roller coaster have locked shut and the cars are slowly shunting along. Nearly there! Quinn points at a sign by the roadside. Someone had scrawled the words, Fright Night, on it. Feels like we're falling off the edge of the world, says Dylan. Then we must be in the right place. I know Quinn's right. The information they sent us said the woods were pretty remote, far from civilization. In the daytime, it's paradise for dog owners who let their pets run free. But at night, it's deserted. We cycle up behind another boy and girl on bikes. The girl looks back and asks if we're here for Fright Night, too. You bet, Quinn says, bouncing up and down on his seat. All the way here, he's been listing exactly what he hopes to encounter in the woods. Dylan had looked at me and sighed a few times, and we both laughed. Quinn can be so hyper. A guy in a yellow vest is standing on the roadside with a flashlight in his hand. He signals at us to turn off the road. We see dozens of bike racks, and we quickly find places. Some other Fright Nighters are already walking around. Who are we going to get teamed up with? And what if we don't get along with them? We have to spend 4 hours together, so it could be a very long evening. I run my fingers over the beads of my bracelet and try to calm myself down. I remind myself that I'm with my friends, Dylan and Quinn. I don't have to do this alone. It's busy at the stand where we have to sign in. The two cyclists who arrived just before us join the line, too. Some guys who did this last year told me they make you sign a contract, says Quinn. I look up in surprise. What? Why? We have to declare that we accept all responsibility for our participation. You know, just in case someone kicks the bucket. I know Quinn's joking, but I can still feel myself getting more and more nervous. Signing a contract sounds so serious. What have we gotten ourselves into?
5 days before Fright Night.
Dylan. So what do you want to do this summer break? Quinn's lying on the bed with a book in his hands. He never reads, doesn't have the patience. My best friend always has to be talking. He spends half his classes out in the hallway because he stops everyone from working. Go swimming? I can't wait to be lying in the pool. Quinn's attic room is so hot. I need to cool down. My own bedroom, one floor below, is way less stuffy. But it still doesn't feel like mine. Quinn's mom and dad have tried so hard to make me feel at home here. They bought a new bed and painted the walls, but I'd still rather sleep in Quinn's room. On the extra mattress on the floor, I can pretend I'm just having a sleepover, like I used to. But it isn't the way it used to be. I live here now, even though it sometimes feels like I just stole Quinn's dad's study. Because of me, Johan has to work longer days at the office now. When I said that the other day, Quinn immediately went on the defensive. What are you talking about? You're part of the family, Dylan. You always have been. It's just that it's official now. I know that's how it is for Quinn, but I still feel like an intruder in this family sometimes. Want to go to the pool tomorrow, then? Quinn gives me a cheeky grin. I bet Sofia will want to come. When I hear her name, I drop backward onto the mattress. I play with the key on the string around my neck. The ceiling of Quinn's room is made up of wooden boards. The cracks between them are the perfect place for secret messages. I always used to roll up notes and hide them there. It feels like centuries ago. Ow! A sharp pain shoots through my nose, right in the spot between my eyes. Then, I see Quinn's book lying beside me on the floor. What are you doing? I yell. You nearly broke my glasses. Quinn grins. I ask you a question, but you were just thinking about Sofia in a bikini, weren't you? Ever since Sofia joined our class at the start of this year, Quinn has been making comments like that, each one more irritating than the last. Not everything is about Sofia, I say. Yeah, but a lot is. Suddenly, Quinn pounces on me. He grabs hold of my wrists and pushes them into the mattress. His face is just a few inches above mine. Admit it, you were thinking about her. Nope, I was thinking about the old days. I try to wriggle out of his grasp, but Quinn bursts out laughing. It's about time you started lifting weights, my friend. Those arms of yours are pretty puny. I try with all my might to push Quinn off, but I can't. Get off me! Quinn shakes his head. Not until you finally admit that you like Sofia. Then you'll just have to spend the rest of summer break sitting on me. The door swings open. I expect to see Quinn's mom, but instead of Hester, Sofia comes into the room. She's here so often that it's kind of like her second home. Quinn rolls off me, and I sit up. Sofia bursts out laughing. Am I disturbing you guys? Not at all, I say quickly. What's up? Sofia drops down beside me on the mattress, and as always, I notice that she smells like she's just spent hours outside, fresh and sunny. You need to see this. Sofia unfolds a piece of paper. It looks like part of a poster. The edges are torn, and some of the words are missing. Quinn chuckles. Did you tear that off a notice board on the way over here? Sofia smooths out the paper. Yep. What is it? I ask. An ad for Fright Night. For what? Your chance to put an end to your fears forever. I reach for the arms of my glasses and push them more snugly onto my face. Put an end to your fears. Sophia's words buzz around inside my head. Imagine if that were possible. I could finally sleep at night, and the bad memories would be a thing of the past.
Fears? I don't have any, says Quinn.
B.S. Everyone gets scared sometimes. Sofia looks at me. Her green eyes warm me and freeze me at the same time. What's your biggest fear? The question takes me by surprise. It feels like the room is slowly changing into a different one. A room with blue linoleum on the floor. I feel the needles going into my arm again. Sometimes as many as 5 in one day. Blood work, IV drips, checking levels of this and that. I couldn't keep count. Heights, I say, making something up. You guys want something to drink? Sofia nods. Yeah, orange soda?
Me too, says Quinn.
I get up off the mattress. My right leg protests as usual, and I almost trip over Sofia when I step across her. As soon as I close the door behind me, I pause on the landing. It feels like I'm wearing a tie that's way too tight. I need some fresh air. I head down the steep attic stairs and throw open the door to my own room. It's dark in here. Out of habit, I still keep the curtains closed. I pull them aside and open the balcony doors. The fresh air comes streaming into my room, and I drop onto the floor and lie down. I feel the wooden floor under the back of my head. It makes me feel calm. There's no sign of any blue linoleum. Your chance to put an end to your...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.